Hey, welcome back to part four of how to upholster a wingback chair. Now, if you're new to this series, be sure to go down to the description and check all the other weeks that I've been documenting how I'm tearing down and reupholstering this wingback chair. Last video, last week, we put the webbing in and we took out these old springs. Now, this is where I was really sort of nervous because how in the world do you tie these strings? I had no idea. I ran out of upholstery classes and I ended up having to purchase six more classes, but that's okay because it means my chair will get done. It will not sit in the garage. And this is what the springs look like now. So in this video, I'm going to share with you how I did it. So if you recall at the end of week three, the instructor had showed me how to just draw around them with marker, make sure that they're placed in the correct position, and then we can get started with the one in the back. Now, if you are used to sewing, if you've done any sort of hand stitching, you probably would be able to do this very simply. We're just going to use some tufting twine, which you'll see in a blue can, and we're going to use a curved upholstery needle. This is so you can easily, you know, just sew these things onto the webbing. It's pretty simple. You want to take about an arm's length worth of tufting twine and thread it through the eye of the needle, and then you're ready to sew it down.
Gonna start from here, going down.
Okay.
Fire. And we start with the knot. Or two. And we go with four loops.
Four loops?
Around that. Unfortunately, most upholsterers do one loop only.
Mm-hmm.
Which...
One doesn't seem like it would be very secure.
Right.
So that was one. Two. So what you see the instructor doing here is taking that needle and going up and over the edge of the spring several times, four times to be exact, and then we're going to secure it on the bottom. And so when it's going down, he's just putting his hand underneath of the chair and just pulling it through and then trying to guesstimate where it goes and just pushing it up there.
So, it would be nice to try to catch them at the bottom,
mm-hmm.
One knot at the bottom of the chair.
So now that we've looped it four times, we'll go underneath of the chair where the needle should be hanging down below, and we'll catch those hooks, those stitches, and then we'll create a nice little knot. Now, he only knotted it once. I actually started knotting it twice. I just wanted to be extra secure, but you know, go ahead and give it a nice little tug and make sure that it's tight. Now we're not going to cut this piece of twine. We're just going to, you know, we've created that knot. Now we're just going to move over to the other side. And I like to think of it as sort of like north, east, west, south. So we started south and now we'll move over to west. But here, listen to the conversation that he and I have about how to proceed.
So we're doing it like north, east, west, south. Right?
Right, exactly.
Okay. Well, that doesn't seem too difficult.
No, but I made it look easy, that's
how about making things look easy, my
friend? Okay, no, that is pretty simple, actually. Okay, so I'll let
all
you
right, breathe. So, then I get
so
to finish
let's go four loops and then one
four loops and
knot
then
at the bottom and then you'll go to the next.
Okay.
You go
and
to
then
the
once
south,
I get over
north, let's say,
to the north. And then once I get here, then I would jump over
exactly
to here. Now let me ask you this. Does it matter? So we started south, we're going west, we'll go north and then east. Does it matter where I start over
not
here?
Not really. But I found that during the years that this is the easiest way. If you start here, one, two, three, four,
uh-huh.
Then when you jump there, you don't waste much of
it. Okay, so then you would do one, two, three, four.
Four, and then from here, right. Then from here, you can just go anywhere. Sometimes I just go there. So come in,
mm-hmm.
there, back here, there.
Oh,
and
yes.
Then I go there.
Okay, so
and there, there, there.
Here, 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 here.
Yeah, here, there, back here.
Okay,
then
and easy to
here.
Jump. Gotcha.
Right.
Awesome. Let's do it.
So it actually wasn't really that difficult. I did the four loops as he suggested that I do. And then when I got to the bottom, I hooked all of the loops together with two knots. And making sure that I didn't cut the twine, I was able to sort of jump over to the next, you know, northeast, west, south of the springs. And then just keep making my way along the entire chair. And when I started to run out of twine, then I, of course, would cut a new piece of twine and make a knot and start over again. But it was actually pretty easy, a little time consuming. You know, there are some other tools that you could do if you are a professional upholsterer. There's some tools that make it really easy to tie the springs down to the webbing. But hand tying them with twine works just as well. And again, moving in that same pattern where you're just jumping from, you know, one spring to the next, making sure you've got all four points covered. It works really, really well. It probably took me about a good 45 minutes to get those springs in, just because I was moving a little slower. You know, it was the first time that I'd done it, so I wanted to do it properly. So, you know, I got to the last spring, and when I was done, it looked really good. Everything was straight, and the chair, when you turn it over, it actually looks like geometrical shapes on the bottom because you've been working in this northeast, west, south pattern. So this is what it should look like on the bottom. With the spring secured to the webbing, we can now figure out how much spring twine we need in order to tie them all together. Now, there's a lot of knots when tying springs together, so you have to make sure each piece is long enough. Here's how he figured it out. He held the piece in place with his left hand and just draped it over the springs to the front. So that very loose measurement he got, he just multiplied it by 3. So that means each piece of spring twine needs to be about that length times 3. Next, he's going to show us how to figure out how many spring ties we actually need. How many pieces do we need?
So let's see how many pieces we need. We need 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9.
How are you calculating?
10, 11, and 12. Every combination of two or more. So it's 2,
okay.
3, 2,
okay.
2, 3, 2, and then 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3.
Okay, so it's like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9.
Right. 10.
10.
11.
11.
And 12.
12. Okay. So 12 pieces that length that we
measured?
Okay.
So in other words, that's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6, 7, 8, 9, and 10, 11, 12.
Okay, so we're putting this in the middle?
Right, holding it in the middle.
Okay.
So I know where I can start with this.
Okay.
In fact, I'll go a little bit more tight bay for the knots and stuff that I'm gonna put on this. So I'm gonna attach this here.
Okay.
So this is how I like to attach that. Usually either one. Or two staples.
Okay.
Folding this on top of itself.
Mm-hmm.
So these are just to hold it in for now, but these are the staples I'm really counting on. Okay. These staples that I'm putting in are pressing this upper layer down over that.
Mm-hmm.
And it's, in fact, it's the pressure that's holding that down.
Okay.
And not the blade of the staple,
gotcha.
Crown of the staple, which may cut. So it's just as if someone is pressing down and holding, or someone has put a clamp here holding. So that's how important it is that you cover that with this.
Gotcha.
So usually what we do is we put as many as we need to now.
Mm-hmm.
But just for the sake of the time, let's do one line and then we do
this.
About 18 inches, 17 or 18 inches is the usual height of chairs.
17 or 18 inches.
Right, from the floor. So there are chairs that are higher and or lower.
Okay.
But that's an old standard of the height. So now we have a loose pillow sitting on top here that's about 4 inches.
Mm-hmm.
So therefore the spring can go down to 14 inches now here.
Wow.
All right, so going to 14,
mm-hmm.
that makes it about 5 inches above the leg of the chair.
Okay.
Let me see if that would work all around. I'm pushing this down to 5, and that looks just right.
Okay.
These pieces are called upholstery boards, and we like the springs to be about half an inch above the bottom of this, so
okay.
About here-ish. And that 5 inch is pretty much where it brings them to.
Gotcha.
So that seems like our calculations are right. So we're gonna push these down to 5 inches from the...
And they'll all be 5 inches pushed down?
All will be 5 inches from the surface.
All right.
Super confusing, right? Well, let's review that again. So if we want this chair to be 18 inches high, we know that the cushion is 4 inches, which means the height of the chair itself has to be 14 inches to get the total of 18 inches. So we have to push that spring down to 14 inches, but we need to know how many inches is that in terms of how tall this spring is. Well, it's 5 inches. That means we have to tie all these springs down to be 5 inches tall.
Okay.
So I guess it's gonna be there. Just to make sure, I'll just pass it through. I hold this here,
mm-hmm.
and my spring is about 5 inches tall. And yeah, looks like it's very close to that. So it's not touching it, it's not touching this either, it's
mm-hmm.
closer to that, so I'll tie it to that one. So the knot is kind of a special. It's a loop over the ring, and then under the ring and through it.
Did you do that again?
No, just there's extra charge for that.
Yeah.
An extra charge.
Over?
Like, I'll show you more. Yes, I'll go all the way to the end of this line. So I'll do it a few times.
Okay.
So double checking, 5 inches about.
Mm-hmm.
And so I pull back to get all this slack out.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm pulling back just next to that line, not up here or sideways.
Okay.
So just next to it. And making sure the top of the spring is exactly above the bottom
mm-hmm.
one. So I don't want it sideways, this way, that way.
Right.
Just exactly on top. And this is about 5 inches from the surface.
Okay.
Pulling back, and now it's locked.
Okay, so that locks it.
Right.
Gotcha.
So the knot is kind of funny when it's...
So it's over?
Right. So, right. The loop
mm-hmm.
and behind and through.
Behind and through. Okay.
Now, the knot, as you noticed, when I was pulling it back, didn't look anything like a knot. It just looked like a twisted twine.
Right.
Except when I pulled it forward, it turned out to be some kind of a knot.
Yeah,
now, the catch to that is if I let go of this tension, that
mm-hmm.
becomes loose again.
Mm-hmm.
It's not a knot that holds by itself.
Yeah.
So I have to somehow manage to hold it. And in fact, the reason we are going with this knot is that it is self-adjusting. So when you tie the whole entire system, if one section is tighter than the other,
mm-hmm.
So as
you
use the chair, it just adjusts itself. It moves
gotcha.
A little. So now I have to hold down to this so it wouldn't
okay.
become loose. I come back here and
pull back
to get this slack out of
mm-hmm.
the line. A little bit tricky, gotta hold close. Then. Now I'm closing these two also at the same time.
Okay, gotcha.
So something to notice, this is no longer 5 inches tall, it's much
right.
more than that, but I'm not worried about it. By the time I get to the front and pull this down,
mm-hmm.
I can pull it so tight that goes back to that 5 inch
okay.
height.
Gotcha.
Ooh, I pulled a bit too much. There we go.
Gotcha.
So I can pull it to go back down, and when I do so, it becomes a straight again.
Mm-hmm.
So, does it? Yes. Okay, good, good. So, now the next spring.
Mm-hmm. Left, so you have to start there, right?
Right. So now we want to close this again. So left
over.
Hand mm-hmm. holds the tip of the loop.
Okay.
Right hand makes the knot.
Okay. Gotcha.
Right hand goes back. I have to let go, but I can't. Mm-hmm. So the right hand holds the previous knot.
Mm-hmm.
The knot itself, not the front of it like that, because okay. that creates looseness. Right back, not from the back of it.
Mm-hmm.
The left hand finishes the knot.
And then you're pulling back and then...
Right, taking the slack out, pulling
gotcha.
Forward. Now, I've got to make sure this is the same distance as that
is it
one
on?
Is.
Okay.
Do I have to turn this
on?
No,
it looks like it is.
Yeah, maybe just.
You're Freeman.
There.
Plugged
it
in.
Gotcha.
Okay, so one more time. Left hand holds the tip of the loop.
Mm-hmm.
Right hand makes the knot.
Mm-hmm.
Right hand holds the previous knot.
Mm-hmm.
Left hand lets go of that and takes the slack out.
And then pulls.
And.
You
want to
plug it
one.
In over here?
So trust me, I understand it is very confusing, and it was very confusing for me the first time that I did it. But, you know, the thing to remember is that the left hand is creating the knots and the right hand is holding the previous knot. This is so that he can remove the slack from the twine and just hold it in place so that it doesn't come undone. Okay, so now that he's tied that part, he can move down to the third. I'm going to call it the third from the top ring. And that's where he's going to secure it. So he'll make another loop, another knot there, again, using the same manner, how he's going over and under, and he's going to hold the previous knot. He's going to remove the slack by pulling it forward and then pulling it down. This is where it can get a little painful on the hands because, you know, you're having to pull it down. You want that to be at 5 inches. And so if you're not wearing gloves, it can kind of cut into your hand. You see how his left hand is really pulling it down there. It's painful. So check the height. Make sure you've got it to where you want to be. Take your upholstery stapler, put a couple of staples there to secure it. And then just like this, you're going to want to put it onto itself and staple it like he showed you in the other clip. And that's going to secure it. That's going to hold it in place. Then all the other ones should be much more simple.
Now, we noticed that we got a concave surface.
Right.
And that's the reason we go down here instead of up here.
Uh-huh.
If you go up here to start with, then
it's going to be too smush.
It's going to be like a dome.
Gotcha.
So we go there and then the top and then we drop down going back here. Now these ends are up and that's where these tails come. We like to have a flat surface, so with this, we just make this flat.
Oh.
Now, if for some reason we need a domey surface, we can still pull more and make it rounded.
Right, so that's how. So how, awesome. Okay.
And then another knot here.
So then you put another one. So then you go back over the whole thing?
And not the whole thing, you don't have to. It is a good thing to do, so it's going to be extra support.
Okay.
But you can finish it here, there, or
so
there.
Then when you finish it, how are you finishing it? Because if there are
just
all...
a couple of knots.
Oh,
normal
so like
knots.
A normal knot.
Right,
okay.
Right. So I'll take this off. I'll leave it, you know, it's just to show you how it
okay.
works. But we'll do this at the end.
Okay. So you want me to go ahead and do this,
please,
this side and this
that
side?
One.
Here's something really interesting about the tail. Be sure to create about 2 or 3 knots around the base of that twine. The reason why is it helps to protect the twine from the edge of the wood. When you're sitting in that chair and the springs are moving, you don't want that twine to get frayed rubbing against the wood. So do that first, but you can also do it later after everything's been tied. So we had 3 pieces of twine used and we still had 9 more to tie. You'll see here that we did the knots to protect the twine. Now I didn't use the tail to secure the top part of the springs, which you'll see later, but here's how we did the springs. We started with maybe the 2nd or 3rd ring from the top, and then we jumped up to the top of the spring, And then we just kept making our way over. So that's the pattern that we used for tying the strings. So now that you understand a little bit more about how the springs are secured to the frame of the chair and where you're actually tying them on the springs, let's talk about the order in which you tie the springs. This is important. So for example, I started vertically, which is fine, but I always want to do the opposite of that for the next step. So you see here, I'm just using some red to color code. That's where I started for the next step, was to actually tie the springs vertically and then horizontally. Then you see by the blue line, I tied these three springs together. And once that was done, then I could sort of do the opposite of that and do the other vertical line. Then I needed to tie together the two springs that you see here highlighted in yellow. And once that was done, I could kind of jump over, do those two springs, and then jump over again and do those two springs, and then finally do the last two springs. And it pretty much looked like this. That's sort of the pattern. And when I was done, this is what it looked like. Now it looks very confusing, but to be honest with you, once you understand that pattern, it really wasn't very difficult at all. And you'll see here where I've got some black circles that indicate where the twine is actually intersecting together, because we'll need to make sure that we secure those pieces of twine together so that they're not rubbing against each other over the years getting weak. So it looked like this. Once it was tied together, it looked like this, and it was pretty secure. It looked much better than the original. This is what the original looked like. And so you can see that it was tied together at certain points where the arrows are, but there was some points where it was not tied together, and that's not correct. So this is what it looks like, the final result of tying all those springs together. And it looks really good. It is going to be so secure and so comfortable. I can't wait. Here's a little bit of footage of the instructor and I tying the final spring ties. The thing I want to tell you is that by the time you get to, tie number 9, 10, 11, it gets really difficult to maneuver your fingers, especially if you've got big hands like me and the instructor. It gets a little difficult having to work your fingers through all the twine. So just take your time, pay attention to where you're, creating your knots. And you'll see here that he's actually creating some knots around those parts that I previously mentioned where the twine intersects. Again, you don't want those rubbing against each other. That's too much friction that could wear them down over the years. So just by creating a little knot as you're tying the springs helps to secure them, and it'll give you a long-lasting chair and you won't have to reupholster it again anytime soon. So here's something really interesting that I decided to do. I'm going to create a little time machine with this chair. So I think what I might do is take a little piece of the old fabric, maybe a little handwritten note or something like that, and I'm going to leave it in the spring section of the chair so that maybe like in the next 15, 20 years, if somebody else decides to reupholster this chair, they'll find it. Isn't that a cool idea? So I love that idea, and I think, it's sort of like a little time capsule, a little hidden surprise for the next person that works on this chair.
I'm gonna put one right here. Taking this slack out.
So then afterwards we'll come back, like once we have all of the, like once we have this one tied, we'll come back and put one there too?
Well, actually as it goes here, being the last one that goes across here.
Gotcha. The tail, right? Okay.
No, not the tail, the main.
Oh, the main twine.
And now the tail going up. This is the last tail that goes here also.
Okay.
Then I'm going to put a knot here.
Mm-hmm.
Seems to be just a bit loose, but this should be fine. There, and too small. There we go. Okay.
And again, we have the tail of that twine that needs to be wrapped around three times with an upholstery knot, and that's going to protect the twine from the edge of the wood. Now we've got the rest of this tail that needs to go somewhere. So usually what you do is you just sort of run it back over the spring. And if there are places such as this spring where we would need to gather all of those pieces of twine together that are intersected together, then we'll do it at that time. And this is how we do it. Remove the slack a little bit, and then when I flip it in the other direction, it sort of locks it into place. I'll still want to hold that with my hand so it doesn't come loose. Now, here's one of those places that I had talked about previously. There's a lot of strings that are intersecting together, and again, over time, we don't want those to rub together and cause any kind of friction that could make them break. Then you'd have to take the chair apart, and we just don't want to do all that. So we're just going to loop it once, again using the same sort of upholstery tie, you know, get rid of the slack, pull the slack out of there, and then just flip it. And then, yep, there you go. You see it's all tied together. So that's going to keep those springs nice and tight. And then we'll jump over to the other side of the spring, do the same sort of upholstery knot. And then once that's done, we will keep going. I think we have enough here to tie it. Let's see what I do here. Okay, so I'm gonna tie it around there, hold it with my hand, get rid of some of that slack, pull it a little tight, and then flip it over. And right where the twine intersects again, I'll just create another knot. So basically what you're doing with this tail is you're just going sort of right back over the knots that you just created. It creates extra reinforcement. It doesn't hurt anything. You see the old knots had some twine together, but overall it just wasn't really good. I mean, what looks better, that one or mine? I think mine looks much more secure. So the real test of whether you did this properly is that you should be able to push down on any one of those springs and the whole contraption should move. If it doesn't, guess what? It means you did it wrong, you missed something, and you have to tear out all the strings and start all over again. So you don't want to do that. Watch some videos, take an upholstery class, watch this video again, and just try your hand at it. It can be a little tricky, but once you're doing it, it's really not that difficult. So in the next video, we're going to talk about how to cover these springs with burlap, how to tie down that burlap, and all the other stuff we need to do for getting this chair to the next level. Remember, go back to thriftdiving.com, enter your name and email, and I'll send you some free ebooks and printables, and be sure to check out the other videos in this series down below. I'll see you next video.